I got made out of jail before coming here. And then I'll be completed. Okay. fine. So, I'll give you a brief summary. So today, we'll hopefully get beyond general discussion. But the general discussion is very important. And so I'll give you a brief summary once again of our main ideas. Pause for questions, and then we'll start trying to understand scale of theories more specifically. So, let me give you a summary with slightly different words than what we've used. We have these renormalization group equations, and we believe the structure of these renormalization group equations is that they're controlled in the infrared by fixed points. There can be many fixed points in a set of in some in space with a grounded with a set of pins. Okay. The thing that's really important for any given fixed point is the set of relevant deformations. Marginal deformations that are marginally relevant count just like relevant deformations. Marginal deformations that are marginally irrelevant count like irrelevant deformations. And irrelevant deformations like that. Okay. Now, suppose we've got a fixed point with two relevant directions. Okay. The flows come out of the board, and the board is the space of the relevant. The flows from far away come out of the board and sort of come in the are quickly attracted to the board. Okay? However, they equally well quickly repelled from the fixed point on the board. So if you were just to do something totally random, you'd land up on the board. The board, of course, is a curved manifold. It's not necessarily flat. You'd land up on the board, but away at infinity, once you float for an infinite amount of time. Okay? That would be the genetic thing. However, we're not interested. You see, these things, for instance, if this was mass deformation, landing up away at infinity would mean turning on a very large mass compared to the energy scale of interest we're from, which typically would give you an empty theory. Okay? We're not interested in such things. So, in the space of such renormalization group flows, what we do is tune two parameters in the UV. We start in the UV, not completely randomly, we start with a two-parameter set. We tune these two parameters so that when we come very near the board, okay, we also approach very near the fixed point. So that at some given scale lambda, as we take lambda not to infinity, we're at a finite point of the board. This was the procedure we implemented. Changing lambda naught and changing the bare parameters so as to be at a finite point. Okay? At some finite scale lambda. Now, let's think about this a little. We were at a finite point at some finite scale lambda. What does that mean for, you know, where were we at scales 1 million times? Okay? So there's lambda naught which we take to infinity. There's lambda which is finite. And now let's make some large number that's somewhere between 1 and infinity. Okay? So some scale lambda prime that's much, much larger than lambda, but much, much less than lambda naught. Because lambda prime is much, much less than lambda naught, we hit the board. Irrelevant deformations have damped out. We're on this modular sheet. But because lambda prime is much, much larger than lambda, in order to know where we were, we do the inverse flow on the board for time log of lambda prime by lambda. But how does an inverse flow on the board look like here? It goes like this. Okay? So now we do the direct flow. What does it say? It's saying that in this process, at scales lambda prime, as the ratio lambda prime by lambda goes to infinity, we are arbitrarily near the fixed point. Okay? So, this procedure. Engineers flows that in the actual limit go and sit almost on the fixed point and then go away. Do you understand? The limiting procedure that we use to define quantum field theories tunes our flows so that they basically are the critical flows. The critical flows are those that go and end up. So you tune it, so that's basically the critical flow with a very small deviation. That deviation goes to zero as lambda not goes to infinity. Okay? But it's tuned so that exactly at scale lambda will be in this finite. This is why, because for any intermediate scale between lambda dot, you know, let's say square root at some lambda prime such that lambda prime by lambda is square root of lambda not by lambda. Okay? We are in the limit lambda not goes to infinity, we are really at the fixed point. It is for this reason that we achieved the statement that I told you about last time. Okay? Namely, that quantum field theories are defined by renormalization group flows away from fixed points. Okay? This is an extremely important, not completely well appreciated statement. That the definition of a quantum field theory, okay, we constructed by this limiting procedure. But all that this limiting procedure achieves is constructing at finite scales, scales about a lambda, is constructing a flow away from a fixed point. So this limiting procedure is one way of constructing it, but it's all it's doing is achieving the following statement, that we want to construct a flow away from a fixed point. So quantum field theories are defined by renormalization group flows away from fixed points. Okay? Now it's a renormalization group flows away from fixed points. See, every fixed point has an infinite number of directions in which they deform. But deformations in most of these directions take you back to the fixed point. These are the irrelevant. Those do not define quantum field theories. Quantum field theories are defined by flows away from fixed points. Continuum quantum field theories, okay? Condensed matter people often use the word quantum field theory to include cutoff quantum field theories. This is not our usage of it. We want quantum field theories that are defined all the way through the ultraviolet in the procedure that we've talked about at the moment. Okay? And such theories are defined by flows away from fixed points. Is this completely, utterly clear? Okay, so the space, so one last thing before you take your question. The space of quantum field theories associated with any given fixed point has a dimensionality specified by some number of parameters. The number of parameters is equal to the number of relevant or exactly marginal operators about that fixed point. Sorry, please.
If you start with the cutoff field theory, then you won't necessarily have float to the back.
You see, we float through the blackboard because we start at lambda not equals infinity. Okay? So if you start with a cutoff field theory, you put a Lagrangian at some finite scale, then you want to be exact. Then you've got an infinite number of possibilities. Okay? So cutoff field theories, roughly speaking, I mean, cutoff field theories are just cutoff field theories. But to the extent that we want to look at them in the neighborhood of these fixed points, they can be thought of as flows that go both the way up towards the fixed point. The irrelevant deformations are not yet damped away. Okay? But we are interested in defining pristine, pure quantum field theories.
How can you have a pure field theory?
Okay, so now there are many things in your question. Firstly, it's easy to have quantum field theories that break the principle. non-relativistic quantum field theory is breaking up. That's not by itself an issue. Now, there are many aspects of your question which are very interesting. One of which is non-locality in space. Breaking this cup of induces some non-locality, some distance scale. Non-locality in space is usually not an issue. Non-locality in time sometimes conflicts with unitarity. Okay? So, there are many aspects to your question which we will not try to analyze. All of which at the moment. I mean, it's a good question, but let's... Okay. Any other questions?
This point is that our surface in the first touch, which you're saying that all the feelings converge to this to a surface, to a 2D surface. So, the point in the relevant, so all the points of relevant direction correspond to those surfaces, and we choose that on which surface we want to land. Like, as you said, that if we go for infinite time, people are going for infinite time. But we have to do some time
period. In the space of all couplings, there is a surface. On that surface, there is a distinguished point. There is one flow line that goes exactly to that distinguished point and stays there forever. That's why it's picked. Okay. Now, there are flow lines in the neighborhood of that that go very near the fixed point, stay there for a very long time, and then start diverging. Okay? So, quantum field theories, which that we define, are defined by flow lines in the infinitesimal neighborhood. Attractive. Is this clear? Because they have to stay in the neighborhood of the fixed point for an infinite amount of time before moving away. Okay? This is exactly what we have to say, the infinitesimal deformations of the fixed point in the relevant directions. Is this clear? Okay. Now, what we are going to try to do. What we're going to try to do is firstly, I'm really sorry about this problem set, which I keep promising will never happen to me. If you will come sit with me one day, we'll sit and make the problem set together, and then it'll happen. Okay, so maybe today. Yeah. Okay, so this because it's a pain in the neck to me. Okay. So now what I want to do is to understand these beta function equations, okay, in perturbation theory for the scalar. Okay? In the problem set, I'm going to ask you to do a straightforward procedure. That is to take Polchinski's renormalization group equations and solve it to leading Dontrogate order in perturbation theory. Completely straightforward procedure. Okay? Just to have a little variety, in class I'm going to work on this problem in a slightly different way, which is, of course, it's the way that Willison would have used. Okay? Just to have many different views of looking at this subject. Okay? So the problem that we're going to address is the following. It's the same problem we looked at as Polchinski. But now we want to get the sign. We want to compute the beta function. That's it. Okay, so we take this action, the bare action is d phi rho in square by 2 plus m naught squared squared 2 plus, let's call it g naught by 4 factorial, g naught squared. That's right. This is our bare action at scale lambda. And in a nice sophisticated analysis, of renormalization group flows, we use this nice smooth cutoff. But in this crude approach to what I'm going to be doing, as opposed to the more sophisticated thing you do in the problem set. Okay? I will just imagine that the cutoff is a sharp. So let's imagine that the scale function, instead of being like this as we assumed in class, it was just this. Okay? So So when I've got an action up to scale lambda naught, all nodes that have momentum less than lambda naught. When I have an action up to scale lambda, all nodes that have momentum up to lambda. Okay? And what I'm going to try to do is I'll compute the effective action at scale lambda. Starting with the effective action at scale lambda naught. You know it's non-trivial. Perturbation theory in this G naught, or as we will see later, it becomes perturbation theory in G. We'll see that. Okay. So this is our goal. I'm going to do this in this crude way just to give you more intuition in different ways of thinking. Okay. The way you do your problem set is more systematic. But this adds a new layer of intuition, so it's more. I think it's a good way. Okay. So what do we have? We've got the actor, we've got the function. Z equal to d phi exponential of minus x. We work in Euclidean space. We took so much trouble to understand how to go to Euclidean space. So we can take just that. It's convenient. Okay. So we've got this action. And we have to remember that because of the hard nature of our cutoff, in this action at scale lambda naught, modes that propagate are all phi modes that have momentum less than or equal to modulus of momentum less than or equal to lambda. Okay, now I want to find the path integral that is equivalent as far as generating correlation functions are concerned. Okay, so for that, as Korchinski does, I put a J P phi B source term. I want to find the action that is equivalent as far as calculating correlation functions are concerned, therefore, is equivalent as far as J depends. To this action, but with momentum cut off at scale lambda.
G of not x.
Well, I'm working in momentum space, if you don't mind. Because I want to make
rest of it.
Rest of it is in position. So it's this plus this. Okay. You can write the rest of it in momentum space. Okay. Why have I written in momentum space? I've written in momentum space because there's something that I want to say. I want to say that J is non-zero, has non-zero support only for momentum. That's why. Okay? So when we're integrating out, so what I want to do is to get an action, which maybe has a different dungeon, but is a path integral over phi, a field phi, with momentum only up to scale lambda. Okay? That will generate the same correlation. Now, how do I do that? What you have to do is very clear. What you have to do is to do the path integral over the modes with momentum between lambda and lambda. Now, some of those path integrals will involve only terms with momentum between lambda and lambda. That will just give you an overall normalization to the old action. Normalization we don't care. Because we only care about normalized correlation. Okay? So it's only those terms in the Lagrangian that involve some fields with momentum between lambda and lambda naught, and other fields with momentum below lambda, that will be of importance. Okay? So, what's going to happen? Well, let's start. Okay. So, because we're working in perturbation theory, okay, perturbation theory in this coupling concept, in order to do this path integral, we first expand the exponential of this coupling constant in a data set. Well, that's what perturbation theory does. So what we get? We get e to the power minus del phi the whole thing squared by 2 plus m naught squared by squared by 2. Okay? And then the first term is minus, oh sorry, first term is 1. Oh, and then there's this plus put a minus here so that it appears to be plus and here. So none of these. Okay, and then d phi, this is what I was saying, same as this. And then we have 1 plus, then there's this term, just g naught phi to the 4, f of it, plus g naught squared, there's a g naught phi to the 4, integral f of it. So this is 1 minus because it's e to minus s, then there's plus 1 minus
Victoria, and so on.
This Taylor series expanding the
expansion.
And now what are we supposed to do? We're supposed to do the integral for all phi whose momenta lies between lambda and lambda naught. Now the point is that in the exponential, different phi modes of different momenta don't talk to each other. It's completely decoupled. Right? The action is just momentum. Okay? So if we didn't have this, we could just do the integral. We would give ourselves an overall normalization. And we would have concluded that since we don't care about normalizations, we would have concluded that there's no flow in the action. On the other hand, we do have this. So what do these terms do? Okay? So let's look at these terms term by term. You see, let's first look at the con. So the one is like not having these. So that does nothing. The first non-trivial term is this guy. This is the g0 phi to the 4 by 4 factorials. By 4 factorials. Okay. Now, we've got 5, 5, 5, 5, minus g naught by 4, and then we take it. Now, we'll take this action and put it in momentum space, because we want to keep track of whether the momentum is below or above. As we've seen before, there are many possibilities. One possibility is that all 4 phi's have momenta between lambda and lambda. These guys, you just do the integral, gives you an overall normalization. Forget about it. Okay? The other possibility is that all 4 phi's have momentum below lambda. But fields with momentum below lambda are just spectators in our this path integral we're trying to do. They're background sources. We don't do anything with that, we just re-exponentiate it. That's just saying that there is a part of the action that goes along for the ride. The terms are of importance are when at least one field lies in the upper momentum range and at least one field lies in the lower momentum range. Now we're going to do this path integral. And as we've discussed, as you know very well, okay, the path integral for with Gaussian exponentials follows Weak's theorem. And in particular, property of that, this is obvious, is that if you've got an odd number of phi's in the high momentum range, you will always get zero. Just because the integral will be zero. Same statement as integral x e to the power minus x squared by a squared is equal to zero. Okay? So the only possibility is that we will have even number of phi's in the upper momentum range and even number of phi's in the lower momentum range.
So we'll take the equation from lambda to lambda.
Yes. But don't get
the zero.
No, because the thing that makes it zero is the integral over d phi.
Oh, yeah.
Yes. Okay? So, the terms of interest are those in which we've got two phi's in the upper momentum range and two phi's in the lower. And when we use Weak's theorem, so let's say that these are the two phi's, they have to be contracted against each other. The contraction gives us a factor of a propagator. Okay? Now, a propagator only runs from one momentum to another. So this was at momentum p, some upper scale momentum p. This is an upper scale momentum minus p. The whole thing is a momentum conserving delta function. So if this was at some p prime, some lower scale momentum p prime, this would be a minus lower scale momentum. Okay? This whole thing is represented by this final diagram, where these are the momenta, this is p prime. The momenta, the lower scale momenta, that come in and go out of the problem. These guys. These are the upper scale momenta that have to be integrated. Is this clear? Completely clear? Okay. Now let's evaluate this graph. Okay. So what we get is, firstly we get minus g naught by Now we have to choose which two guys. Which two guys to choose as the upper scale members. Clearly there's 4 into 3 ways of doing it. Okay. 4 into 3 divided by 4 factorial is half. Fancy people will tell you this graph is a symmetry factor of half. Okay. So and then we do the integral. Now what is the integral that we have to do? The integral that we have to do is d, let's say we're four dimensions. D 4 b by 2 pi to the power 4. 1/p² from lambda to lambda. Upper to lower.
So we can use by 6 years.
What?
You should choose by 4 into 3 by 2, right? You should be 4, you are not by 4 by 3.
No, no.
So it was 6 ways, yeah. You took 12 ways, right? 6 ways, right?
I agree with you, just one.
So it should be 4c2, right?
You're probably right. Yeah, you're probably right. Thank you. Just there. Yeah, you're right. It's by 4. But you know, this is called, it's what you should have. Thank you. He's right. It's possible too. But this is going to contribute to an effective action, which will change the mass square, which has a by 2. So it's factor of 2 less than its contribution to the effective action for a bare mass. So it's this, the right symmetry. And now they're saying this is that if we compute, yeah, you're absolutely right. By 4. Absolutely. Okay, great. Okay, thank you. Okay, and then that's it. And then of course, what remains is 5p, 5 minus p, but we can rewrite that in position space. That's just 5 squared. With only the lower momentum contributing. So you see, what this graph does is give you a shifted effective mass. Okay? Now, let us assume that lambda naught is the largest scale in this point. Okay? If lambda naught is the largest scale in this problem, what is the leading order behavior at large lambda naught of this integral? Well, it's d4b by b squared. So it's lambda naught squared times some number that you can easily compute. We'll have the volume of the 3-sphere in there and so on. We'll keep track of it. Right, so we get delta, so we get some number which we can control. So we get minus g naught times some number which we can compute by 4 times log of lambda naught, and then depending on whether lambda is larger than or less than this mass, okay, let's assume that this mass was very small. This would be by lambda. If the mass was comparable to lambda, this could be a more complicated function. A function of n by lambda. Sitting in there, you'd have to do the integral. That doesn't matter. That's a lambda not dependent set. That's clear. And this is the theorem. Okay? Is this clear?
What is
the p squared? P squared? No. This p is a dummy vector.
No, that's fine.
Over here, you have like d4 by d squared. So, what do you have like d squared? What do you have the quadratic form? It's a quadratic form. 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 It's a
quadratic form. It's a
Now let's see, why is this Lorentz non-invariant?
We're putting
So what Lorentz transformations are rotations in this Euclidean space. Lorentz transformations are rotations. Something is below one p, a rotation of it remains below. You might have thought mixed translations. we will moment in space. This is not free moment. It's for moment. Okay? That's why we've gone to Euclidean space. So as to be able to do it in the limits. Is this clear? Okay? Fine. What is this saying? This is saying that when you do the integral over the intermediate momenta, you pick up an additional contribution to the mass. An additional contribution to the mass. Okay? In addition to what you actually had in your version of the Lagrangian. Okay? Of order the bare mass square. You see that this is an additional contribution to the mass? Okay? Because now we can re-exponentiate this. Okay? So it would in fact be e to the power minus m naught squared plus whatever this was. Number by 2. The whole thing by 2. Number by 2 lambda naught squared.
Why was it important? Well, if you, at one point you made the comment that we have to assume that lambda naught is a bigger scale.
No, no, actually, I was mistakenly thinking that there was a log.
Okay.
Yeah. For the leading term, there's nothing. You don't have. Oh, yeah, you have to assume that lambda naught. No, you see, if m was a what? If this denominator was something. No, you're right. Even if m was order lambda naught, it's to change the rule. relevant operator in the game, there will be a fine-tuning we will have to do. Right? It's a crazy fine tuning. If you think that the theory is just built at random, if you think that at this high scale, if you think that they're at, that we're not doing mathematical constructions of field theory anymore, but we're actually looking at some the real world, where there is a theory at Planck scale, at some scale, effective Planck scale, lambda naught, which does some physics, and then happens to give you whatever it will, you might think that, well, it'll choose some effective naught, whatever it is, and then the effect, the mass that we will get down at a low scale will be some m naught squared, which typically was always lambda naught squared. That's because that was the mass scale that ended physics. Minus some lambda times lambda naught squared. No particular reason for these two numbers to cancel sensitively, in which case we get a field of huge mass. In which case, we will conclude that every scalar field in the theory, by the way, for fermions, chiral fermions, there are protection mechanisms. Chiral fermions cannot be given masses, etc. But for scalars, there are no protection mechanisms. Okay, without superscription. Okay, so that we know. Yeah. So you might think, therefore, that if physics at some high scale, okay, was totally, you know, was generic in some way, okay, that every scalar field in the problem at a much lower scale it would end up having a mass of order that high scale square. Even if that physics was somehow special, so that it chose mass equals zero at that high scale, even so at some low scale, we would end up having a mass of order lambda. Okay? Now this conclusion, this very simple calculation, little conclusion, appears to apply to the real world. Because in the real world, as has been experimentally confirmed last year, there is a scalar particle named the Higgs boson. The Higgs boson has a mass of about a TeV. 125. And this scale is far separated from the other apparent scale in physics, namely the Planck scale, or the unification scale. More or less the same. Okay? And it remains an uncomfortable, though not sharp, puzzle of nature that this mass is so heavily separated from that scale. Because it seems to be saying that the physics of at this higher scale, where, that either there is a mechanism to stabilize this. Such a mechanism exists in supersymmetry, but we've not yet seen that works in the real world. Or there was a conspiracy. The conspiracy was that the high scale of physics was such that is m naught squared, that the m naught squared for the scalar field was chosen precisely so that it would cancel the m naught that you got by renormalization root flow running down to the scale. And this is much more impressive than this calculation makes it sound, because as you can imagine, there are contributions to this mass at this order, one loop, this is called one loop. There are also contributions to two loops, which would go like g squared, at three loop, at four loop, and so on. And while each of these contributions is suppressed compared to the other by a coupling constant, the coupling constant is, let's say, 0.0, 0.1, 0.2, you know, the real world. So the suppression is not very much, whereas these masses are very large. So this cancellation would have to be very impressive cancellation, up to very high order in perturbation theory. Okay? In order for it to give us what is observed. So this leads to what people sometimes call the naturalness. The thing is that if you had high-scale physics that was somehow agnostic about what happens in the UV, in the IR, well, it does something natural for it in the UV, maybe something that sets M0 to some nice value, but nice value that is local in scale space, that doesn't know what will happen once you flow down, then it sounds totally absurd that this cancellation is happening to some such high precision. Okay? This is a puzzle. Sharp one, because you know it's not like a mathematical contradiction. UV theory, whatever it is, could have chosen this, but it seems somehow very odd that it knows about what's going to happen in the end, especially given the decoupling. Anyway, so this I don't want to spend too much time thinking about It's not a sharp puzzle. Unsharp puzzles often lead to a lot of waste of time. Yeah, because I'm serious. You can spend a lot of time thinking about a puzzle that actually, when you see it correctly, just evaporates. It's not a puzzle. When the puzzle is not very sharp, what's really sharp is to have a mathematical contradiction. Two formulas that are saying different things. But Planck had a great contradiction. Yeah, he was onto something. Black body radiation was infinite. Yeah, I can compute it. But yeah, I measured. It's fine. That's contradiction. You know, these other things are a bit hazy. Actually, black hole information paradox, I fear, might be a paradox of this second sort. You know, how do you put your hand on exactly what the paradox is? So maybe there's no paradox. You know, that kind of, you know, one should always be suspicious of paradoxes which cannot be clearly stated in terms of formulas. Okay, but anyway, fine. But this is what people talk about when they talk about the naturalism. Since it's talked about so much, especially in the context of things, I thought I would mention it for 5 or 10 minutes in the class before we move on to more serious stuff. Go on.
Why put landowner as kind of a blank scale? I mean, just because the new fleet is above it,
yeah.
I mean, you still have to worry about all the RGs that get you down to the blank scale, right?
To the blank scale. But let's say that whatever it is at blank scale, we start that. That's unlikely to be some quantum field theory about it. Okay? Because from all indications, it doesn't matter. But from, there's some new physics, whether quantum field theory or not, doesn't matter. But whatever it is, let's say that we believe that it's likely to be a quantum field theory below Planck scale, at least much below Planck scale. Okay? So the framework of renormalization group flow should apply from, let's say, 10 to the 14th GeV onwards. At least that should be. That's enough to build your barrier.
Does it help if you have, say, some new fluids, let's say 10 TeV?
10 TeV, it makes the paradox less of a paradox, but still quite a paradox.
Because you still have
10 orders of magnitude is not that much easier to. Now, what it would help is if you had new physics at order 1 TeV. And that new physics was of the sort that stabilized the boson. Okay? Well, supersymmetry actually is great for. Supersymmetry is a symmetry that links what's going on with bosons to what's going on with fermions. So if you've got a fermion that's chiral, so chirality protects its mass to zero. That same thing is protects the bosonic mass position. Okay? But this linking of fermion mass to bosonic mass happens only when supersymmetry is a symmetry. Now, in many supersymmetric scenarios, supersymmetry is spontaneously broken. We'll discuss things like spontaneous breaking. Possible. Most of you know about it, right? So, supersymmetry is spontaneously broken. So, at and below the scale of the spontaneous breaking, this protection ceases to apply. And so, it's very natural then for a scalar to gain a mass of order the scale of spontaneous breaking or supersymmetry. So, if you had supersymmetry well, broken at scale of order of TeV, scale of order gains mass, that would beautifully explain this.
If you are breaking just in the couplings are all that is needed to protect the scalar mass, then if you break it at 10 TeV or 100 TeV or even higher than that, it's broken only the mass, but not the couplings.
Well, it's broken spot.
If it's spontaneously broken only in the mass.
It doesn't matter. Whether it's broken in the masses or the couplings, it doesn't matter because in intermediate, you see, once you feed into loops, the fact that the mass is
broken.
Yeah, everything will get. Okay. So, so that's the kind of thing that would explain it. But we have not, you know, the most comfortable explanation of that sort would have seen super partners by now. At any rate, we've not seen them. Maybe we will in the next one. But one should be suspicious. Because often things that are going to happen just happen. Without postponing to the next one, Okay, yeah.
Nicely looking at this expression, m naught square has to be negative of another square quantity.
Right.
So does that contradict the fact that in the Lagrangian the mass term becomes a negative term?
Yeah, it becomes a negative term and the bare mass term becomes negative. But that doesn't matter because you see, effectively there is terms coming from interactions that are cancelling. So you see, the path integral that we are doing. Yeah, now you might ask, what are we actually doing here? You might ask, does this make the path integral unstable? I wrote it as F naught square. You could have just written some number that's my square. And that number you will agree, at least if negative function not here, at least if G naught is positive, is negative, and yes, that's fine. But you may ask, you know, you might ask, you might worry that our whole procedure makes no sense because of this. Okay, so it's true, what you say is true. And the worry might be that our whole procedure makes no sense. Okay. And your worry might be formulated as follows. Look, this integral is nice and well defined if M naught is positive. Since we're doing perturbation theory, we're doing an integral with this M naught operation. So if you actually have to start with M naught square negative, your whole procedure is different. This might be your worry. Okay. And it's a good worry. So but actually what we would do to deal with this worry is this. You know, actually what we would do is to write this quantity here as m squared and then put in m naught squared minus m squared. Now remember that m naught squared minus m squared differs from, starts at origin. So it's also a coupling constant effect in that sense. Okay? It's m squared, this, the mass square at a physical scale that we will keep in the bare. Okay? And that's actually consistent because these other things, these m naught squared minus m squared, all basically cancel each other once we get to the loose case. So, good.
So, this is the fine-tuning essentially, right?
What? This is the fine-tuning. No, but here at the moment, the fine-tuning is that you have to start with m naught squared that cancels this object here at some very sensitive level. But now there is a question of just consistency of procedure. Okay? You see, we're doing some path integral, and we don't want to use a bare path integral. We're doing some path integral, and we're doing the path integral by dividing it up into free and interactions. Now, it would be inconsistent procedure for that free path integral to be ill-defined. And the free path integral would be ill-defined, as you say, if n naught squared was negative. You see, because the path integral, the integral dx, but AX squared, where A is positive, is not well defined. Okay? So, that's when you raise a legitimate worry, but we can easily deal with that. Okay? So, let me deal with that in the following way. Okay? So, in order to perform this integral, let me suppose, okay, so now of course I have to know how do I choose my M naught square. Okay. I will choose my M naught square to satisfy a renormalization condition. My renormalization condition is that at scale lambda, my mass is some fixed M square. Okay? So this quantity, whatever it is, okay, plus M naught square. So, okay. Let's be more accurate. Okay. What I will now do, and this is a good point, it's actually important. What I will now do is to say the following. Let me say that I'm going to modify my procedure. I'm going to modify my procedure to write this as d phi squared plus m squared. M squared is the renormalized mass, the mass that I want to establish. Okay? At scale. Okay? Phi squared, phi 2, plus g naught phi to the 4 by 4 factorial. Okay? Plus m naught squared minus m squared by 2. I don't yet know what m naught squared minus m squared by 2 is. But I know that it's order g. Because if coupling was 0, m naught squared would be m squared. Okay? And then the plus j. Okay? And then I will do perturbation theory in this whole quantity. So now, see, this part remains unaffected. But in addition, I get, I have to put it down, a minus m naught squared plus minus m squared by 2. And then I have to demand, the whole point was that in my Lagrangian and scale lambda, I wanted no mass term except this. So I have to demand that this is it. Okay? What's important here is that the mass at low scales is what determines the stability of the problem.
Do you have a simpler solution? Because it's not n naught squared, we have p squared plus n naught squared.
But p ranges of all values, including 0. We have to do the path integral over all phi. Okay? If any one of those modes is unstable, it's unstable.
Should I write how that solves the problem? Because this thing is what you've written.
Yes.
M naught squared plus some number g naught.
Yes.
M naught squared is m squared, right? So if you subtract m squared from m naught squared, you're getting a quantity which is not of order g, but of order lambda naught squared. So that thing is still lambda naught squared.
What thing is lambda naught squared?
M naught squared minus m squared.
M naught squared minus m squared is lambda naught squared. In fact, it's exactly what this is.
Yes. So how does it solve the problem?
No, it just solves the technical problem that in the bare, in the free part of the path integral,
there's still a phi squared there. Integral of
but this part we're dealing with in perturbation theory. We're just doing, pulling this down one by one. You see, what we're doing is a path integral. Okay? I just want to make sure my procedure is consistent.
Right. That's where I am.
Yes.
The thing is, you're first doing a one-loop integral. You're showing that the m squared, or rather the m squared diverges, or delta m squared diverges.
Yes.
And then you're putting it back, and then you're doing the first quantum integral again. I mean, doesn't that seem very
self-contradictory?
Yes, exactly.
Let me just word the procedure differently.
Yeah.
Okay. Let me start the procedure by saying that I'll take my action before doing any integrals. Okay. Write it as del phi squared plus m squared phi squared by 2. Okay. Plus j naught phi to the 4 by m squared plus m naught squared minus m squared by 2. I've done nothing. This is just true. Okay? I don't yet know what m squared is. This is true for any m squared. Okay? Now, what I'm going to do is, as we will see self-consistently, this quantity, whatever it is of order g naught.
It's also order of lambda naught.
That's fine. G naught will be the smallest scale, the smallest number in the world. Lambda naught is some scale. Okay? You see, perturbation theory in the end will be perturbation theory in the renormalized term. Hang on for 2 minutes. You see, we will get everything fine. But if you want justification of this procedure, take lambda naught, it's something fixed. And make g naught small enough so that g naught times any power of lambda is small.
We could have done this in the previous step. I'm sorry for being so insistent.
No. You couldn't have done this in the previous step because we would conclude that m naught squared was a negative. So in the previous step, you would have achieved a self-inconsistency. Okay? You would have said that the procedure that you adopted was not self-consistent because it was doing integral to the form e to the pi x. No, you should be insistent. No, it's great in class if there's... You know, I may often say wrong things. You have to correct. I mean, that's how a good class goes. And please don't apologize for that. Yeah? But you see, it's not that it's order lambda naught squared. That's not the finding. The finding is the fact that the number behind the lambda naught squared has to be exactly the same as what you get. The order is not finding. Order is what you expect. It's that the number has to be exactly the right. And not just this one. You know, when you do the two-loop calculation. You see, at one loop we would get this. At two loops we would get one more term. Three loops we get another term. And this would have to cancel all of those. You see, that is a huge difference. huge, huge conspiracy.
So does N not complex?
Complex? N not could be, N not square is not complex. N not could be matched. It doesn't matter. Call this a number. Don't call it a number. Call it a game. It's a term of the Lagrange. It's a real term of the Lagrange. You see, you could have a tachyonic mass in the belly. That's what we see. As long as the mass in the physical, once it goes to low scales, is not tachyonic, we don't care. Okay? However, we do care for the procedure. This is the good point that you were saying. Manibratha. Manibratha made a good point that even if there's some deep physical reason why we only care about the mass and the IR, my procedure was self-inconsistent. Because I should be doing Gaussian integrals with negative M naught squared. It's well taken. And it's an important point. And this is how you could cure it. Okay? Just by shifting your imperturbation theory. Let me say that. When you do perturbation theory, is an automatic procedure once you know what to start perturbing around. The question about what to start perturbing around is an art rather than a science. Okay? And it involves intuition. It involves guessing where you are near the right answer. So if you try to do perturbation theory around the wrong starting point, you get trouble. And that's what Manibratha pointed out. We were getting into trouble because we were starting doing perturbation theory around the wrong starting point. Once we shift to the right starting point, we won't. This is the right starting point. It's a good point. Okay? Yeah, go on.
When you're doing the fine tuning, you're obviously adding a quantity which is very large. How much of cancellation do we want? I mean, because we have no a priori value of M.
So we have no. So in this theoretical context, we just wanted to cancel it to M, whatever it is. Okay. It's in the real world that you can estimate that.
Exactly.
And so there is huge fine-tuning.
So that comes from its value?
That comes from its value. Yeah. So he was saying, what is this fine-tuning? It's true that you have to cancel this to this. But then what you're left with is some M. So how can we estimate the the fine-tuning? Because, you know, what is M? And in theory, it could be anything, right? M is parameter. So fine-tuning is fine-tuning once you're in a situation, a real-world situation. And the real-world situation that we are in, there's huge fine tuning because M naught should have been order of Planck scale, but it's order T, 16 orders of magnitude. That's the whereas G is just.
So, this integrity first factor, effectively,
you do what? No, if we started with an effective subduction at scale lambda, then we would have no issues. Then, you know, the bare mass would be the vectors. But we don't know the effect of square running. You can do the RG running, but you see. Yes, you can. Yeah, exactly. So, then, if you started with what we started with and did the RG running to get effective Lagrangian, but now you still have the following thing. You see, you have to know what M naught to start with. So, in order to define a quantum field theory, how have we done it? We define the quantum theory saying that we start with some M naught and lambda naught and so on, so that we flow to Lagrangian at scale lambda where the mass parameter is M. Okay? So we have to do our adjustment. Okay? However, we thought of it. Was that your question? Okay. In fact, from this Puljinski renormalization group equation, you can use it. You know, to solve that equation in perturbation theory, as we go along, the perturbative parameter is G at the low scale. So we'll address your question really clearly. In a while, probably at the end of this lecture. Okay? This question was, what was the true perturbative parameter? We'll address that very clearly. Hang on. Okay, good. Other questions about it? Fine. This was the mass. This running of the mass at one loop, it's not much of a surprise. Okay, now let's look at what happens in two loops. Let me take this here. When we take that guy, we've got this guy and this guy. I'm representing the 4 phi to the 4s in an area. Okay? And once again, what will we have? well, you could have this and this. But this is already accounted for. Because if you take the diagram we've computed and exponentiate that diagram, like we did, we just added that up in the mass. If you exponentiate the diagram, that generates this product of these two diagrams. That's nothing new. Okay? The genuinely new diagram that we have in this order is this. Okay, and then we could have a like extra mastery normalization, for instance. Or we could have had an extra mastery normalization, more complicated, we could have had an extra mastery normalization diagram. Like this. Okay? So where everything that runs a loop are high scale, and everything that's outside are low scale. Alright? This thing would be some complicated additional contribution to this thing of order G scale. Would change nothing conceptually. It would be pain to calculate and so on, but changes nothing particular in our way of thinking.
The
right
diagram is of G square, that's the GP or this.
What?
Third diagram is of
GP. Third diagram is of GP. Yes, you're right. Sorry. Sorry. So perhaps this is the only thing in G square. Is there anything else? Yeah, I think that's up down as made.
A sunset kind of thing.
Well, yeah, of course you could have this, but that also is taken account by iterating, just adding this.
No, sunset.
What?
Sunset diagram.
Sunset. No, this, by the way, this is not possible.
No, I'll
come to your diagram, but just to say that this is not possible.
It's like one
pair. No. There's no one pair here, we just took a path of difference. Why is it not possible?
So it's not
an active pair. What?
It's not
an active
pair.
Who has told you have an active pair? We're not surgeons. Why is it not possible? It's not possible in momentum correlation. You see, this was a low scale one. And everything in here should be high scale momentum. But between here and here, we have delta function. Momentum conserving delta. So this was low scale, this would also have to be low scale. What? All external lines in these fiber diagrams are low scale. All internal lines are high scale. Such a diagram is impossible. So you see, Wilsonian renormalization group automatically tells you non-amplitude diagrams are not generated. Okay? This we will see from a different point of view when we examine the quantum effect collection. From Lejeune, the transform, that's one. But from the Wilsonian procedure, it's just automatic. Simple fact about low and high scale, part of it. Okay? Yeah, sunset diagram. Yes, maybe you're right. You're saying this diagram, right?
Yes.
Yeah, you're right. This is a new genuine mastery normalization term. In fact, it would be more than mastery. It could also generate some wave function renormalization. Okay, I'm going to put that aside for a moment. We could compute it. But the much more interesting effect here is this thing. Okay, that's the one I'm going to focus on. Is this okay? Now, let's look at this diagram. What is this diagram? Okay, and here we really, there's a sign we really want to get right. This is the sign of the beta function. Okay, what is this diagram? This diagram, well, firstly there are two. There's minus g naught times minus g naught. Okay, so we get a plus g naught. Then we have a 4 factorial of the whole square. Right. And then a 2 factorial from exponentiation. Okay. And now we had 5, 5, 5, 5. 5, 5, 5, 5. Okay? Now what we have to do is to take each of these 5's and group them up in two groups of two. The two that will be low scale momentum and the two that will be high scale momentum. How many ways of grouping this up into groups of two that will be? This is the thing you corrected me on. So this is 6. Get another factor of 6. Once we've grouped into groups of two, the two that we're going to contract up have two different ways of contracting. Okay? So into two. Okay? So let us check what that is. Let's check what that is. We will get so we get g0 squared. The 6 cancels 24, leaving a 4. So there was an 8 left over. 2 cancels this 2, so there's just a 4 left over. 4 into 6, so 24. Right?
So there should be
1/16. Okay, let me check that again. Not that math as well. This is 24 into 1/24. Into 6 into 6. Yeah, you're probably right.
So there should be 1 more.
Into 2 by 2.
So there should be 1
more. Why?
So if you have 2
by
2 by
4,
that is equal.
That's
a very good thing. But that is not. That is a
good thing. Which what? I've got 2 by 2 to the first. I've got 2 5 to the first. In each of them, I have to choose 2 that I will contract with, contract, and 2 that will not contract. See, what you're thinking of is that suppose I had, I'm going to contract this with some external lines, with momentum P1, P2, P3, P4. Then the guys with P1 and P2 can choose to contract with either this guy or that guy. That's not what we're doing. Okay, it's a different counting from what you're doing. Yes. Yeah. Why? You remember it was 4 minus n. N in this case is 4. So it would be lambda to plus c. This is a classically marginal. The dimension of the coefficient was 4 minus number of points. Okay? So let me just check what this thing was finding. 16. Everyone agrees it's 16. I haven't checked it. Okay. Great. So what we get here is, so with g0 squared by 16. Okay? And then we get what this guy gets. Now, because of Manibrato's correction, okay, we put an L square, not an m0 square. It's a big one. Okay? So we'll get d4b by 2pi. 4 over r squared into p. Okay, now let's suppose that the momenta that go into this, these low scale momenta, whatever they are, that go into this graph are p1, p2, p3, p4. Okay, delta function tells us that p1 plus p2 is equal to p3 plus p4. Minus, plus p3 plus p4 is equal to 0. Let us call P1 plus P2. Let's call that P. Then this graph will be P plus R whole square. P4. Same square. Is this clear? Okay. Because let's suppose that this momentum is R. This momentum will be P minus R. These are the two propagators in the graph. What? M. See, because we are starting. We start. Okay. Okay. Now, let us look at this graph. This is actually how this graph was when we started our discussion. if you remember, we started that discussion saying we offer a normalization, saying we compute this with exact direction, and we found that it was divergent. This is not the answer, divergence. Again, we have to do this integral from lambda to lambda naught.
Sir, shouldn't there be just one integral, like integral d for
that? Thank you. We have to do this integral from lambda to lambda naught. So what will we get? We get g naught squared times the volume of the three sphere, wherever it is, 2 pi squared. Somebody wrong? 2 pi squared? Pi squared. 2 pi squared. Anyway, volume of the three sphere. For the volume of the unit, okay, times by 16 times r cubed dr, this is by 2 pi power 4, okay, by r squared plus m squared times p plus r. Let us suppose for a moment, just to keep life simple, that this mass here was much smaller than even lambda. We don't have to finite scale, but much larger than a mass. So we can ignore that mass. Then we can compute this diagram. And now if we are interested in the... So this diagram is now of course a function of moment of this capital P, P1 plus P2. But let's say we are interested only in the term in the 5 to the 4th theory that is independent of momentum. You know, the coefficient that would be g4. Because g4 is the term when you take 5p1, 5p2, 5p3, 5p4, there's no factor of momentum. So I'm going to compute g4. Yeah. For that term, we said we can set p equals 0. Do you understand this? Let me say this again. The whole expression here is some analytic function of capital P. Okay? So we get some effective phi to the 4 coupling, which we can Taylor series expand in capital P. That will give us various values of the coefficients that we call G4N in our discussion of the position scalar normalization group, terms with higher and higher derivatives. Suppose we are interested in the term G4 0. For that, we just set p equals 0. Okay? So we set p equals 0, and what do we have then? That is really easy. We've got g4 squared, 2 pi squared by 16 into 2 pi to the power 4 times. Now, because m is effectively 0 compared to the cutoff, it's lambda and lambda naught, p is also 0. There's no scale in the problem, okay? Yeah, and you easily see that this thing is basically just log of this is log of lambda naught by lambda, because it's just dr by lambda. Okay. So what have we concluded? We've concluded that G4 at scale lambda, okay, that G4 at scale lambda, okay, now let's exponentiate this, okay, let's exponentiate this back again. We're going to have to, we soon can play the same trick that Manuel Gomez played, but first let's just exponentiate this back. If we exponentiate this back again, what do we see? We've got a plus here, but in the exponentiation, we take it to an e to the power minus s. Okay? And so what we conclude is that g4 at scale lambda is equal to g0 minus g0 squared 2 pi, all these numbers. No, I take the relatives. You see, I've taken this up. With, there's a relative minus sign between G0 and this. However you say it. Okay, that's the thing I'm saying. Right. If you think of the effective phi to the four vertex, it's minus G0 plus this. It's minus G0. That's the relative sign.
Why the mass
term? Yeah, I'm just choosing to do this at scales lambda that are much, much greater than. Okay? If I choose this, then everywhere in this integral, since R only runs between lambda and lambda naught, since R only runs between lambda and lambda naught, then everywhere in the integral, R is much, much larger than n, so we can forget. That's just a simplification so that we can see the answer quickly. It's not essential for you. Just so that you can see. Okay? Fine. So this answer can be read in many ways.
Sorry, I don't understand this. What is G4 lambda?
What
is G4 lambda?
G4 lambda is... Okay. Remember, what we're doing is this Polchin's. We're trying to do this Polchin's scale normalization. So, in the effective action at scale lambda, we have a 4-phi coupling. The 4-phi coupling has Taylor expansion in all momenta in the phi fields. We're taking even the term which has no momentum. Okay, the coefficient of that is G4.
This G4-0.
What?
This
G4-0. G4-0 at scale. G4.
Should I call it that?
It's that G4-0 at scale. That's what I call it. Okay? Yeah?
Sir.
Yeah?
Sir, since there is a relative sign between G0 and G0 square, like, won't we have that same m squared problem? Like we tackle the linear case, like g is not case. No.
We're going to have the same problem, and we will soon come to similar kinds of problems, and we'll cure it in the same way. We will always keep the physical couplings in the thing we will expand around, and shift to the other things.
But isn't it a little inconvenient to do it every time for each order? Because you get 1 plus 1 minus.
Yeah. So you know what you do is just start with this thing with g squared plus other things. Anyway, actually we don't even have the same problem technically because you see in the Lagrangian we're expanding around the thing we're using to generate perturbation theory g is not. So in this case you don't need to. You see, you needed to do it because you needed to generate Gaussian path integrals. Those have to be well defined. That's all the reason. So it's okay, not necessary for perturbation.
Right, because I mean, if there was plus sign here, then G naught would have to be in the negative, and the issues of partial integral divergence at negative G naught.
The issue is partial integral divergence at negative G naught. We cannot judge whether the partial integral diverges or not. You see, because it's a non-linear partial integral, they all get the things. Right? The point was that each integral you actually perform as perturbation theory has to be converged, and G naught is irrelevant for that. Okay. Now, let me look at this formula. This is a very important formula. We'll take 10 minutes extra maybe today. This is a very important formula. We will try to get it straight. We will try to understand it in many different ways. The first way to try to understand it, okay, the first way to try to understand it is as follows. If we want to keep G fixed, okay, if we want to keep G fixed at scale lambda, okay, if we want to keep G fixed at some scale lambda, okay, so if we want to keep G fixed at some scale lambda, how do we have to change G naught? How do we have to change G naught? Okay, as a function of lambda. Okay, in order to keep G fixed. That's one question you could ask. Okay? And another question you could ask is, suppose we started with some value of G naught, and we go to different values of lambda. How does G of lambda flow? Let's address that second question first. The question we're going to ask is, does it increase or decrease? Okay? So, as we go, as we go, this guy becomes larger, but it's a larger negative number. So roughly speaking, it looks like it decreases. But this is not very satisfactory for many reasons. Firstly, in our general analysis of the Kulchinsky renormalization group, you might remember that we had the general statement that dg by d lambda was a function only of g. When we take dg by d lambda according to this equation, we get a function not only of, we get something which knows about g naught. That's not very satisfactory. Right, so we had a general expectation that is not being borne out by this calculation. But the point is that the general expectation is a general expectation for the exact result. Okay? And could perhaps be borne out once we take into account all perturbative corrections. A class of perturbative corrections that do what we want. So let me do that first before interpreting this formula anymore. No. Higher order the exponential would be higher order of the exponential would be like this and this. Disconnected graphs. This is not a good thing. Actually, connecting these graphs. Okay? Now, you see, what are we getting? Each of the integrals in each of these bubbles is exactly the same. Can you see that? Because each of the integrals only knew about the net momentum running through these graphs. And the net momentum running through the graphs is the same. Okay? So up to some factor, what we're going to get, so this, suppose we have n such bubbles, we'll get g naught to the power n. Okay? We'll get g naught to the power n, and times this integral, that integral, whatever it was, some I of p lambda naught lambda. Okay? That to the power, so this would be n plus 1, so this to the power n. Okay? And then we're going to get perhaps a factor. Okay. So I'll leave as an exercise for you to check that the factor is just trivial. That this factor is the form that takes this guy and makes it a geometric series.
So
what
are we doing other graphs contribute?
No. All graphs contribute. I'm just summing a class of graphs. This is one of the sets that contributes. Summing a class of graphs, you get a better answer. Okay? That's effectively what the renormalization group does. It makes you sum classes of graphs. Bit by bit. Hang on. Okay. So, you see, here now, instead of getting g, the net effect is the following. Instead of getting g naught minus this thing, what this turns into is g naught, you know, 1 plus. So g of lambda, g of lambda, is equal to g naught into 1 plus g naught into this I of p, which is some number, okay, positive number, times log of lambda naught. Okay? And this formula can be written as follows. Let's write this formula as 1 by G4 I'll write this here, I'll divide through by this guy. So right, this is 1 by GT. That's the same thing. Now I take this to the left hand side and that to the right side. So 1 by G4 of lambda is equal to 1 by G0. Okay? Plus positive number times log of lambda naught by lambda. And then this here is simply the integrated form of the relationship. This here is simply the integrated form of the relationship. D by D 1 by G of lambda. Okay. By D log lambda. Is equal to minus lambda or b by d log lambda of g of lambda is equal to number g squared. This subclass of graphs does have the property that we expected. Namely, dg by d lambda was a function only of g. Okay? And it's a function of g of lambda in the way, so that as log lambda is made smaller as you go to the IR, okay? This guy decreases. Captures the feature. It really correctly and honestly captures the feature that as log lambda is made smaller, this guy decreases, going off to zero. On the other hand, as lambda is made larger, g increases. Okay? This, of course, is the statement that this coupling g was marginally irrelevant. As you flow to the IR, that is making lambda smaller, g goes to zero. Not at first order, but at second order. By the way, log lambda is minus the t that we had. T was flowed towards the IR. So it's d by dt is equal to minus. So it's irrelevant. Is this clear? Okay. So we have established by this computation. That the 5 to the 4 coupling, in the free fixed point of the scalar theory, is a marginally irrelevant coupling.
So, we chose those graphs by the curve convenience, right?
Chose what terms?
Those kind of graphs.
We chose those graphs by convenience. Okay, you see, what you could have done was to say the following. You could equally have said that. Suppose we just took the one loop graph. Yeah. Then you could have taken g of lambda, whatever we had, right? G naught minus g naught squared times number times log of lambda, right? Lambda naught by lambda. Okay? Then you could have computed dg by d. Okay? And what you could have got is equal to plus g log lambda. We have got plus g naught squared number, exactly like we've got, except we've got g naught squared. And then you could have said we know from general analysis that the right answer has to be a function only of g squared. Now, to leading on in perturbation theory, g naught agrees with g. So, what function of g agree would at leading on in perturbation theory give you g naught? Well, it had to be g. Okay, so you could have just done it that way. But I found it more satisfying to actually sum the graphs to show you that if you did do the perturbation theory, it will actually happen. It doesn't address, of course it addresses the issue. It tells you that, you see, what am I claiming? I'm claiming that we get plus G naught. What we got from a 1-2 calculation is that it was plus G naught. Plus number times. Okay? Now, the general analysis we had said that if you worked it out to all of us, you see, general analysis says that we've got to get some function of G. Okay? Now you want a function of G such that at leading order it reduces to G naught. There's a unique function. That's G squared. So it has to be that the right answer is G squared. But what does it mean that the right answer is G squared? It means that if you computed all the higher order connections, you would get many other terms. Okay? One effect of those many other terms would be to replace this G naught squared by G squared. I've identified the graphs that do that. You see, so what we're going to get, what we will actually get, we got this plus G naught squared. Okay? So now if you do, let's say, two loop corrections. One of the things you will get is this. And another thing you will get is some genuine new term. Okay? So you get this thing, plus some other G naught, let's say, Q. But once again, that would be a function only of G naught. Now, the right answer would be replacing this guy also by G.
So you can take other graphs and do this kind of stuff.
You can group graphs up.
Yeah.
So that one effect is only completing the series. And in addition, you get new terms.
Yes.
So if you went to four loops, then you would have to have the term that you get by completing this guy, the term that you get by completing this guy, plus something new.
Yeah.
The point is that in perturbation theory, you can actually identify these graphs. Like I've done here, I've identified the set of graphs that completely change this into G. All the other, the remaining graphs at two loops will contribute to the new. Okay? Similarly, at three loops, I'll be able to identify the guy that completes this guy. And then the remaining graphs will be the new thing. I'm just saying that the renormalization group effectively organizes perturbation theory in a slightly different way. Because it organizes it, and this is getting to the answer to your question, in a perturbation in G, not in G naught. Okay? That's the point. We'll understand this point, maybe not this class. Better. We'll understand this point better as we go on.
Sure, part of the answer to this question is simply that G doesn't change in linear order. I mean, we don't find any graphs which just changes G in linear order.
Linear in what?
Linear in G. Linear in G. So the change in G is always G squared or higher.
Yeah. So the corrections to G is equal to G naught plus higher order.
Yeah, exactly. So
exactly.
The beta function will always be G squared.
So this G naught squared does agree to leading order with G squared. But the only thing it could have been then was G squared. This we argue from what else could it be. But at least I found it more satisfying to actually identify the graphs that convert this into G squared. Okay? At every order you can do that. You see, the great thing about the renormalization group as Polchinski formulator or Wilson formulator is that it's a differential thing. So when you iterate a differential, even though the differential is only generated by like a basic graph like this, the iteration of that differential, that same term generates all of these graphs. So if you use graphs to compute the small scale renormalization group, the iteration of that differential generates all orders graphs in the, that's basically what's going on. We will, to say it again, quantum field theory has perturbation theory as perturbations in the physical coupling constant, not in the bare coupling constant. And that's what this resummation of graphs is showing. And actually everything is organized as function only of the physical coupling. Okay? We will understand this point much more clearly as we go along. That's a very important point. That the bare coupling actually plays no role. Apart from some auxiliary device in constructing the theory, it plays no role in any physical quantity. And that, in the end, will be the answer to the question that you asked at the beginning of the class. Okay? I mean, seeing what we use in this. Okay. So what have we established? What we have established is this equation, that's called this one, and this equation, that's called two. Okay. Now, the equation one can be read in and out. No, but this is the point. The point is that there will, you will be able to always identify sums of graphs that do that. That if you get a lower order, lowest order, you get a G naught. There will be sums of graphs, like we've done here, that effectively convert that G naught into G. Do you see that that's what's happened here? We got a G naught square when we looked at just one graph. But there was a whole series of graphs that we could just identify, which turned that into a G square. This is a generic thing. Okay? So the fact that perturbation theory is perturbation theory in G is a reorganization of the graphs of perturbation theory. You can reorganize the graphs to resum such things, the graphs, to make a perturbation theory explicitly in G. That's the point.
So this it's a graph of all order of magnitude. All order of perturbation theory is integral to the perturbation.
What?
Doing graphs to all orders in perturbation theory.
Yes.
In some sense, integral to this approach. Like, very.
It's a reorganization of perturbation theory. It's taking. You don't do all graphs at all.
We are not looking at
it. You don't need to do all graphs at all. You organize an infinite set of graphs at all orders in perturbation theory. Another infinite set at all orders. A simple infinite set.
So this arranging is inbuilt in that theory, you see?
It's automatic. See, if you didn't want to do this, you could have used the argument we did. That you get G naught squared, just compute the function. We know that it has to be a function only of G squared. This you remember, right? There is a structural feature of the beta function equations. That dg by d lambda is a function only of g. So you could ask, well, we know on general grounds that this thing has to turn out to be a function only of g squared. Okay? That doesn't depend on where you started with in the renown. You know, so this is not a, it's not an issue of accounting. It's a serious issue. It means that you don't need to have solved the renormalization root flow to know what the beta function is here. It's a local relation, right? So the dg by d lambda is determined purely by what your g is there, not how you got there. Okay? That is a physical thing. And I'm saying you can see this if you want to at the graphical level. If you're just willing to accept it for the purpose of computing beta functions, no, forget about it.
But how to decide this graph you should iterate to all?
You need some experience. We will have more to say. Okay. Hang on a little bit. Okay. It's a very important part of renormalization theory, that perturbation theory is perturbation theory in the renormalized graph. Okay? And we will have more to say about this. Okay. But before we get there, take this equation one, and read it in another way. Let us read it as the following. What do we have to do to G naught of lambda naught as we change lambda naught in order to not change G4 of lambda? Okay? So what do we have to do to G naught of lambda naught as we change lambda naught in order to not change G4 of lambda? And we get the same equation. You just differentiate it.
D by D log lambda naught of G naught squared is equal to same number times G naught squared.
There are two different minus signs that cancel each other. First minus sign from the fact this is our answer term. Second minus sign that these are changed. So we get exactly the same equation. So we see that two things have the same answer. The answer to two questions obeys the same differential equation. The first question is, how do we have to change our pair coupling as we change lambda naught? How do we have to change our pair coupling as we change lambda naught? Okay, how do we have to change our pair coupling as we change lambda naught? In order that the physical theory at scale lambda remains fixed. You must change it according to this equation. And G naught must be evolved according to this. Differential. The second question, once we have chosen the pair coupling, if we change the scale of our physical coupling, how does this G of lambda change? Okay, that also is given by this equation. Okay? That also is given by this equation. Okay. Okay. Now, as we have seen, G of lambda goes to 0 as lambda goes to the ultraviolet. Conversely, G naught becomes larger and larger as lambda naught becomes larger and larger. If we take this equation seriously, there is a limit to how large it can become. Because, you see, the running is in 1 by G. So when lambda naught by lambda becomes so large that it becomes equal to 1 over g4, then this must go to 0, and therefore g naught must be 1. So if we plot two things, how does g of lambda, as we go to the IR, minus 1, behave as we go to the IR, we see that, so that the answer to that question is that, so let's do two plots. The other plot thing we're going to plot is how the G naught of lambda, lambda naught goes, function of log, as we go to the UV. So, let's first plot this. How does G naught of lambda naught go as a function? As we go to the UV, there is a particular scale. There is some particular scale. That scale is given by solving the equation. There's a particular lambda that's called a lambda. Okay? And lambda is given by the solution to the equation. Number times log of lambda by lambda. Is equal to 1 over g4 of u. Okay? Or, exponentiating both sides, lambda is equal to lambda times e to the power 1 over number times g4 of u. Okay? This scale here is the scale at which G naught goes up. Okay? So we plot in log lambda, well, let's plot in lambda naught. Let's plot in log lambda. This thing, G naught rises, and then at log lambda, it blows up. Okay, this is an example of a renormalization group flow to the extent that the one loop approximation is reliable. Okay, it's an example of a renormalization group flow to the extent that one loop thing is reliable. That cannot be continued all the way to the infinite. Okay? Seems to tell us that this theory, okay, seems to tell us that this theory with fixed g of lambda at some fixed scale lambda is not a well-defined quantum field theory. This, of course, we already knew from before, because it's simply the statement that this coupling is marginally irrelevant rather than marginally relevant. And we cannot define quantum field theories perturbed away from a fixed point in a marginally irrelevant direction. Okay? This is this older manifestation of that statement. Okay? This observation was made by Landau in the context of QED. Something very similar happens. The place where this happens is called a Landau pole. Okay? And it was taken by Landau correctly, it turns out, to signal that those quantum field theories were not really well defined. We have a much better understanding of this. It's just simply the statement that's a marginally irrelevant direction. Okay? But this is still useful from the point of view of seeing how you get a problem as you flow towards the IR sometimes. Because QED, well, this theory is a fine effective theory. But it needs new physics before that, sometimes much before that. Okay. Great. So this
does it affect the alternative nature of this way before we hit the line of?
Yeah, right. So this is not a reliable conclusion. Yeah. To the extent that you can this is an indication from one loop. Okay, it's the one loop manifestation of the fact that we're dealing with the marginal irrelevant, basically. Okay. Now let's also plot g of lambda versus log lambda, versus minus log lambda as we go to the end. Okay. So how does g of lambda look? G of lambda, that's fine. We got that here. It's as we go to the IR, this guy is becoming infinity. So it goes to zero like one of x. This curve. The fact that G is damping out. Okay? The fact that G is damping out to its fixed point value. Because fixed point is just a fixed scale. Okay? And it is basically the curve that tells us that G of lambda was marginally irrelevant. Okay? So this concludes my first brush with the study of the renormalization group flows of a very simple theory. The scalar field theory in four dimensions. Okay? And here we say that the net summary that you know there is the fixed point. There is a fixed point, which is the adjustable simple, just the free field theory. Okay? And it has only one marginal direction, which is the master. Sorry, relevant direction, which is the master, continues to be free. We have not succeeded in our attempt to build a non-trivial quantum field. Okay. A quantum field theory does not. So far, using scalar field. Okay, now let me say, I've done less than I hope to today, let me say one quick thing. Okay, before we start now, one quick thing. You see, you had these. We found that this phi of lambda was a marginally irrelevant operator. So that tells you that there is no quantum field theory defined as a flow away from the free fixed point. That is anything but free. But does it tell you that there is no phi to the fourth theory? No scalar field theory with phi coupling? No! We have to be careful about things like this. Because in the space of renormalization group flows, there could have been another fixed point. It was not inconceivable that there is a second fixed point. So let me ignore the mass direction and draw just the G4 direction. What we are saying is that the G4 inflow towards the IR in this fixed point is this way. But it's not inconceivable that there was a second fixed point here, such that G4 would be a relevant direction for that fixed point. quantum fields theory here could be well not defined as a flow away from this prefix point, which we just concluded does not have interesting enough relevant directions, but defined as a flow away from this fixed point. Do you understand? There could have been, just in the space possibilities, a new fixed point such that quantum field theories are defined by renormalization group flows that hug these, go there, and in the high R go to this fixed point. Then, if this was the case, this fixed point would have just been an accident. Something that expresses the fact that this field theory, whatever it is, becomes free at low energy. Okay? But the theory would have been defined by this fixed point. Such a possibility is so the question of is phi to the 4 theory in 4 dimensions a trivial theory is effectively the question of does there exist a new fixed point of this one. Now you see, because this fixed point, whatever it is, does not occur at 0 G4, it's very hard to answer using perturbability. Because the flows away from this fixed point, the existence of this fixed point flows away from another point, would not, if it existed, would not be perturbed. So you might think it's very hard to rule out. However, there have been extensive lattice searches for such fixed points, and nobody's ever found it. And I don't really know what the situation is now. I remember when I was a PhD student, David Gross saying there's an almost proof that it doesn't exist. It's probably an almost completely complete proof. I mean, so this theory could in concept have existed, but as far as we know, it does not exist. We are not aware of any fixed points in the space of the single scale of. Okay, other than the prefix point. Unfortunately, the prefix point is true. So in 4 dimensions, we completely understand the set of quantum field theories with one scalar field. We completely understand it because it's a trivial set. We strongly believe that for a single scalar field, there's nothing more to do in quantum field theory in 4 dimensions. You know, you could go and say that you know everything that anyone will ever know about quantum field theory in 4 dimensions for a single scalar field. Because you studied depressing shoulder chapter. Okay, by quantum field theory, you know, all the caveats, I don't count cut off quantum field theory as one thing. I count them only flows away from fixed points. I count it as field theories. Of course, for condensed matter physicists, they may be lost. Okay, but from this pure point of view, there's nothing left. However, it turns out that the situation is different in 3 dimensions. Okay? And that's what I had hoped to tell you about in this class. 3 dimensions are very interesting because the quantum field theory of 3 dimensions governs the phase transition of liquid to solid, of ferromagnet, ionizing ferromagnet, and so on. We'll understand why all these are true. Okay? It's very interesting. And then it turns out that there is a non-trivial quantum field. You can define phi to the 4 field theory in 3 dimensions. That you can define phi to the 4 field theory in 3 dimensions is obvious. Why? Just because in 3 dimensions, what's the dimension of the operator phi to the 4? Somebody? 5 is dimension half. Therefore, phi to the 4 about the free field point has dimension 2. And therefore, it's relevant. It's less than 3. So, in 3 dimensions, phi to the 4. Not as a matter of subtlety, but just as a matter of dimensional analysis about the free fixed point is a relevant operator. So there are 2 dimensional space of field theories in 3 dimensions. So clearly you can define interactive field theories with a single scalar field theory. What's interesting is that what the situation turns out to be, as we will see, the reverse of this. The reverse of the one right option. That you take this free fixed point, define the quantum field theory is obtained as the set of renormalization group flows away from it. Okay? And if you flow in a particular quote-unquote muscle's direction, the infrared limit of this is another fixed one, which has only one relevant definition, which is like analog of the mass definition. So it's the inverse of what I want to do. The free fixed point has two relevant definitions. There's a new fixed point, however, which has only one relevant definition. The relevant definition you should think of as m squared fixed point. Okay? This is very interesting. Let me tell you why. I'll tell you why in just 1 minute. You see, as I said, and as we will explain in much more detail, suppose you take a three-dimensional Ising model. As you know, it undergoes a phase transition at some temperature. Okay? And as I will explain, the theory at the phase transition point is an effect of three-dimensional conformal field theory. It's defined as a quick thing. But you say, in order to get this phase transition, as you change temperature, you hit it. This tells you that in the space of renormalization group flows, if you take a one-parameter set of initial conditions, you somewhere hit the phase transition. This tells you that the number of relevant operators of this conformal field theory must be one. Right? Because if you're starting the space of renormalization group flows, and there were two relevant operators, then you would need to choose two conditions in the ultraviolet in order to hit that point. Generically, you choose range one, you'll miss this. You see, this set of renormalization group flows that can end up in the fixed point would be co-dimension two if there were two relevant operators. Okay, but since you chose changed only one parameter here, namely the temperature, and I hit it. It strongly suggests that the set of renormalization group flows that hit the fixed point is co-dimension one, meaning there's one relevant. So this fixed point here, this free fixed point, is not a candidate for the scale invariant behavior of the Ising model at its phase transition. Because there's too many relevant operators. There are two of them. Okay? On the other hand, this one, because it has exactly one relevant operator, is a candidate. It's called the Wilson-Fisher fixed point. It's what got Wilson and Fisher the Nobel Prize. Did Fisher get the Nobel Prize? I suppose they both got it. Okay, it's what got some people got Richard Feynman's prize. Okay? And it governs the scale invariant behavior of magnetism as well as the solid liquid. Beautiful, very interesting quantum field theory, which we'll study next. Okay, I think that's it. About today's class. Okay, I don't. Okay, you know, if you want to read about it in the words that I've, roughly the terms I've said it, I don't know what to say, frankly. You will find as you grow up that you will find no quantum field theory textbook satisfactory. That's how it goes.
Yeah.